So first, I would like to thank the organizer for the invitation and for letting this special event happen. So today I will speak about treatment effect estimation with missing values. So my main collaborators on this subject are Inke Meyer, one of my PhD students, and Jean-Philippe Vert and Stefan Wager. And these works are mainly motivated by medical applications with some of my collaborations with Paris Hospital. So to illustrate this topic, let's consider a COVID data set where I have COVID patients described by some variables that can be categorical or continuous, such as, for instance, the value of D-dimer or the value of blood pressure. And my aim is to estimate the causal effect of the administration of a treatment, for instance, hydroxychloroquine or hydroxychloroquine plus azithromycin on survival, here 28-day mortality. So this task is challenging when you do not have a randomized control trial, but rather observational data. So here, the mortality rate for hydroxychloroquine patients is equal to 18%. And for non-treated patients, this is equal to 24%. So we may want to say that the treatment helps. However, if we have a look at the data, so for instance, the distribution of the age for the treated patients and non-treated patients, it turns out that younger patients are more likely to be treated, but we also know that they are less likely to die. So consequently, we need methods to be able to disentangle the effects of age to the one of the treatment. So this phenomenon, where both the treatment assignment and the outcome are driven by some covariates, is known as confounding. So to be more formal, I will consider the potential outcome framework of Neyman and Rubin, where I have a sample of N patients described by some covariates in X, a binary treatment in W, and the potential outcomes corresponding to the outcomes we would have observed had we assigned treatment or not to the patients. So the individual causal effect of the treatment is defined as the difference between the two potential outcomes, but of course it can never be observed because each patient is either treated or not. Nevertheless, if we are willing to make some assumptions, we can estimate the average treatment effect, which basically corresponds to the difference in mortality between treated and control patients. So the first identifiability assumption is unconfoundedness, so which states that the treatment assignment, W, is independent of the potential outcomes of the treatment effects given the covariates. So in other words, we have observed all possible confounders to be able to deconfound the data, to mimic a randomized control trial. So for instance, if X corresponds to categories of age, within each class of age, the treatment assignment is considered to be random. The second identifiability assumption is overlap. So to define overlap, we need to define the propensity score, which is E, as defined as the probability to be treated, W equal to 1, given the covariates. And this propensity score is bounded away from 0 and 1. So this assumption makes sense because imagine a case where all the smokers are treated, it will be impossible to know if what you see is due to smoking or again due to the treatment. So given these two identifiability assumptions, we can estimate the average treatment effect, for instance, using the historical classical inverse propensity weighting estimator. So this estimator is defined as a difference between weighted means, where each observation is weighted by its inverse of the propensity score. So for instance, here, if we have a treated patient with W I equal to 1, And if this patient has a small probability to be treated, a small propensity score, then we will put a lot of weight on this patient. So the idea is really to balance the two groups, to make the two groups of treated and control similar, to be sure to observe the effect of the treatment. So this estimator is consistent if the propensity score is consistently estimated, but it can be biased if we do not estimate well the propensity score. And in addition, it can be very variable because we divide by probabilities. So in the literature, there are other estimators with better sample complexity and also better statistical properties, such as the augmented IPW estimator. So instead of using only one model for the propensity score, so the model for the treatment given the covariates, there is an additional layer of modeling with the model for the outcome Y given the covariates. So here denoted by mu for the treated, W equal to 1, and for the non-treated with W equal to 0. And then both estimates are combined to form this estimator, augmented IPW. So I'm not going to detail the specific shape of this estimator, but what is interesting is that this estimator is known to be double robust. So it means that it is consistent if either the outcome functions or the propensity scores are consistently estimated. So what is powerful with this estimator is that you can use to estimate your regression function and your propensity scores any machine learning procedure. So for instance, you can use DeepNet, Random Forest, without harming the interpretability of the causal effect. So your aim is still to estimate the impact, the effect of the administration of hydrochloroquine on survival and to give a confidence interval. So it is really a statistical aim, but using machine learning tools. So this is not the end of the story, because with observational data and with any data, often there are many missing values. So here, I represented a bar plot of the percentage of missing entries for a subset of variables. And you can see that it varies a lot. So from nearly 0 to 60% for some variables. And it's not possible to delete the observations with missing values because in addition to leading to a potential bias if you delete a subpopulation of your data, it may lead to the deletion of almost all your data. So this is not a possibility. So the first contribution that we made on the topic of causal inference with missing values was to classify the methods in three categories according to the different assumptions that are required both for identifiability of the average treatment effect and for estimation of the average treatment effect with missing values. So indeed, you have two issues. You have causal inference with missing causal inference and also missing values. So you need to couple the assumptions. So in the first family, we define non-confoundness assumption adapted to missing values, and we may require or not to specify the distribution for the mechanism that generates the missing values. In the second family, we have classical unconfoundness and classical missing value mechanism. And in the third family, we have another notion of unconfoundness and classical missing value mechanism. So for the first family, new unconfoundness with missing values and hypotheses or not on the missing value mechanism. Let's first recall that unconfoundness can be seen as a strong assumption. But it turns out that often medical doctors can provide you the graph which gives you the confounders, so here in pink, that are responsible both for the allocation of the treatment and also for the outcome. Then, unconfoundness with missing values can be defined as follows. So, we condition on X star instead of X. So X star corresponds to your data with missing values. So equal to Xij when Xij is observed and to Na for not available when this is missing. So R is the indicator matrix coding for the missing values. And this is the element wise multiplication. So you can see that your data does not live in a vectorial space, but rather in a mix between a continuous and categorical data. So that's why often it's complicated to work with missing values. So unconfoundedness with missing values can also be seen as a very strong assumption because it implies that units may have different confounders depending on the pattern of missing values. So for instance, for the patient one, X1 is not a confounder, but X2 and X3 are. Whereas for the patient two, X1 and X2 are confounders, but not X3. But in practice, this assumption is plausible if you have access to the same information as the doctors when he decided to allocate the treatment. So in other words, if the doctor used only X2 and X3 to decide to treat for the first patient, the assumption is met. So the assumption will be violated if the data are erased a posteriori. So if we are willing to make this unconfoundedness assumption with missing values, then we can use previous estimator, so namely the IPW or AIPW, but we need to replace estimation of the regression function and of the propensity scores by estimation of generalized propensity scores, where we condition on X star instead of X, so X star, the data with missing values. And it turns out that it is more complicated than meet the eyes, as already highlighted by Rosenbaum and Rubin in 1984, because there is a combinatorial issue because there is one model per pattern of missing values and they are 2 power d, d is the number of features pattern. Nevertheless, this problem can be seen as a problem of supervised learning with missing values because your aim is to predict here an outcome given the fact that you have covariates that are incomplete. And consequently, we can make use of recent consistency results that states that if you want to do supervised learning with missing values, as soon as you have a super powerful learner able to learn any function, then a simple constant imputation, like mean imputation, can be consistent. So consistent in the sense that it targets conditional expectation of the outcome given the incomplete data set, so you achieve the base rates. In addition, if you are using trees-based methods like random forest or gradient boosting, and you want to do supervised learning with missing values, you can use a splitting strategy known as missing incorporate in attributes, where the missing values are incorporated in the splitting criterion. So there are more details on both approaches in the paper Consistency of Supervised Learning with Missing Values that we developed with colleagues. So consequently, we implemented such an approach in the GRFR package in causal forest in the average treatment function, where we estimate the generalized propensity score and the generalized outcome regression functions with random forest, but random forest adapted to missing values with this missing incorporate in attribute strategy. Missing incorporate in attribute strategy does not require to specify any mechanism for the missing values. So that's why I previously said that our approach is valid when you have unconfoundedness with missing values and also no missing value hypotheses. So then, using classical results from complete data, we can show that our estimator is root n consistent, asymptotically normal, given weak regularity conditions, that the product of root mean square error of the nuisance estimates decays as faster as 1 over square root of n. Okay, so this is it for this first families of method. So for the second family, we require to have classical unconfirmedness, but also hypotheses on the missing value mechanism. So we have already defined unconfirmedness. So let us recall classical assumptions for the missing values. So Rubin defines three types of missing values, namely missing completely at random, missing at random, and missing non at random. So let's illustrate this with an example with two variables, systolic blood pressure and gravity score, and we have missing entries on systolic blood pressure. So missing completely at random means that the probability to be missing is independent of anything. Missing at random means that the probability to have missing values on systolic blood pressure may depend on gravity score. So for instance, we do not measure for too severe patients. And missing non at random means that the probability to have missing values on systolic blood pressure depends on the values of systolic blood pressure. So for instance, we do not measure when the systolic blood pressure is low. Missing completely at random and missing at random are known to be ignorable in the sense that you do not need to specify a distribution for the mechanisms that generate the missing data when you do likelihood-based inference. You can ignore this mechanism. Whereas missing non at random is known to be more complicated to handle, and so that's why many methods assume missing completely at random and missing at random. So if we are willing to make these two assumptions, classical unconfirmedness and missing at random, then we can use the following strategy to estimate our average treatment effect with missing values. So we can resort to multiple imputation when we are going to generate different plausible values for each missing entries, leading to different imputed data sets. And the variability between the different predictions, for instance, 3, minus 7, 7, reflects the variance of prediction of missing entries given observed data and an imputation model. So once you have your imputed data, different imputed data sets, you can apply on each imputed data set an estimate like the IPW to estimate your average treatment effect, and you combine the results to get point estimates, but also an estimation for the variance that integrates the supplement variability due to missing values, the variance of prediction. And it turns out that Shiman and co-author show that such an approach is consistent to estimate your average treatment effect if, in addition, you assume that the covariates are Gaussian and that the model for the outcome given the covariates is linear and for the treatment given the covariates is logistic. So this is for the second family. Last family of methods, we are not going to assume that our covariates X are anymore the confounders, but they are only noisy proxies of the true latent confounders Z. So that's why we have latent unconfirmedness. So the graphical model associated to this assumption is the following one. So we have the confounder Z related to the treatment W and to the potential outcomes. But these confounders Z are unobserved. They are latent variables that generate the observed variables X that in fact are not completely observed because they have missing values, because we have R the mask and what we observe is X star. So the simplest instance for a latent variable model is a factor analysis model, where we assume linear relationship between the variables. friend, we assume that the data X are generated as a Lorentz structure and kept in this latent variable Z, corrupted by noise. So consequently, we can estimate these latent variables using the data with missing values, X star, for instance, by using matrix completion methods. And with these estimates, we can plug this Z hat in classical estimators like the IPW or AIPW, or in a regression model where we explain the outcome by the treatment W and the confounders. And Nathan Kalus and co-author show that this estimator is consistent for the average treatment effect with missing values that are missing completely at random. So missing completely at random comes from the fact that you use matrix completion. With colleagues, we have extended this approach, but to a less parametric framework to take into account non-linear relationships between variables. So consequently, instead of relying on Lorentz approximation, we consider a deep latent variable model. Then, our aim is still to estimate these latent variables given the data with missing values X star. And for that, we used results from Mattei and Frelsend, who derived a variational autoencoder with missing values. So in particular, they consider a simple variational families where they imputed the missing values with a constant, for instance, zero, and they show that with such a family, it maximizes a lower bound of the observed likelihood. So that's why they consider like missing at random, because the aim is to maximize the observed likelihood. So with this machinery, we are able to have samples from the variational distribution, this Q of Z given X star. But often the variational distribution is not necessarily a good surrogate for the posterior distribution. And consequently, we resort to important sampling to be able to draw from the distribution of Z given X star. So with these different samples, we define two methods. The first one, misdeep causal, which has a flavor of multiple imputation, because on each matrix Z, we estimate the average treatment effect, for instance, using an AIPW estimator, and we combine the results. The other method that we proposed is misdeep causal with preprocessing, which can just be seen as an heuristic extension of the matrix completion framework, because we use only the point estimate Z hat, and we plug in this Z hat matrix in classical estimators. So we have seen that there are many methods to do causal inference with missing values that depend on different assumptions regarding the unconfoundness assumptions and the missing value mechanism, but also in fact on the distribution of the covariates X and on the models for the treatment W and the outcome Y that can be parametric or non-parametric. So I have described three families of methods. In fact, I have not described this other method, SAEM, which is a method which also assumes unconfoundness with missing values. But in comparison to the method implemented in the package GRF, we require to have missing completely at random or missing at random for the missing values, and also covariates that are Gaussians and a logistic linear model for the outcome and the treatment. So there are many methods, but it matters. So in fact, we performed extensive simulations varying the data generating process, varying the outcome model, the treatment model, the percentage of missing values, the kind of unconfoundness hypotheses, and so on. And there are no overall best performing method. So this assumption matters. So for instance, here I have a simulation where we simulated according to this unconfoundness with missing values. And we can see that as expected, the GRF method, which is here, is asymptotically unbiased. So you can see that really it is asymptotically because it's here, 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 and here, and then we get an unbiased. What is amazing here also is that the method SAEM is unbiased all the time, which makes sense because this is a parametric method relying on estimation of a logistic model and a regression model. But what is interesting is that this method relies on a Gaussian assumption from the covariates, and here we have generated data according to a mixture model. So it's stable with respect to deviation from some hypotheses. In the case where we have a complete data unconfoundedness, mice multiple imputation strategy is in fact still here a bit biased, but this may be explained because often it requires many different imputed data sets. So in all the simulations that I have observed, mice is often quite good, but often there is still a small bias. And some other methods may be really biased. So here the true value is in black. So in the same way, when we are under the framework where we have non-linear relationship between variables and not so and more complicated relations, our approach, Miss Deep Causal, is unbiased as expected. And this is especially true when the number of features D is really larger than the number of latent dimension Q. So when the covariates are really like super proxies of the true confounders. Okay, so consequently, on a real data set, I will have a tendency to try the different methods to cope that assume different hypotheses. So here on the dataset, we have, for instance, use IPW and double robust estimators to estimate this average treatment effect. And then we use the different methods to deal with missing values, with matrix factorization, GRF, or multiple imputation. In light blue here, we can see the raw effect. So remember at the beginning that we say that if you just look at the data, you have the feeling that the treatment helps. But after taking into account the differences between the two groups, it turns out that all the confidence intervals contain the zero. So it means that with the data, we cannot reject the null hypothesis of no effect of hydroxychloroquine on mortality. So to conclude, the missing values alter the cause analysis, so you need to be careful with respect to the assumptions. You can find further details in these three papers, and there are a lot of things to do. In particular, I am deeply interested in coupling observational data and randomized control data, so there are a lot of challenges in terms of missing values as well. And we are working on heterogeneous treatment effect and also on other architecture to integrate the missing values within this causal framework, and also on methods that rely less on the assumptions for the missing values. So I thank you, and if you have any question, I will be happy to answer it. And you can find also a lot of information, just an advertisement on our website, Armistatic, dedicated to handle missing values.